Okay, thank you. So this is joint work with Krishnendu Chatterjee, Wolfgang Dvorak, and Monika Hensinger. And basically, our motivation was to determine the algorithmic complexity of certain of natural planning objectives. And our model was the discrete model, so where you have a finite explicit state space. Basically, a state is a vertex in a graph, and when you go from one state to the next, you take a transition. You take an edge. Okay, and we looked at this problem, these objectives in different environments. The deterministic environment, so this is graphs. The nature environment, this is modeled with Markov decision processes. And the adversarial environment, where you use games. Okay. So this is the first objective we looked at. This is basic target reachability. I guess most of you will already know this. So you're given a set of vertices, and you want to know if you can reach one of them from the starting position. And in this case, it's obviously yes, because you can just take the uppermost path, and the robot is fine. Okay. The next objective we looked at was coverage, where you have k different target sets, and the question is, can you satisfy basic target reachability for each of them? So what this is like, imagine the robot is in a spaceship, and he has certain tasks he needs to do, or there are certain emergencies, and for each of these emergencies, he needs to know if he can reach the countermeasure on the spaceship. So, and in this case, it's also possible for if the first emergency occurs, he goes to this vertex in T1. If the second emergency occurs, he goes to T2. So that's the second objective, coverage. And the last objective we looked at was sequential targets, where you basically you're again given k different target sets, and you need to reach a vertex in T1, and then a vertex in T2, and then a vertex in T3. So basically, imagine the robot is transporting resources around. And yeah. And in this case, it's also possible to achieve the objective because it just takes the uppermost path. Then he goes down, and then he takes the loop to T2, and then he goes to T3, and he's done. Great. Okay, and now we look at different, now I'm going to present to you the different models. So the first model is nature, where you extend the graph model with probabilities. So in this case, the starting vertex instantly leads you to some nature node, and basically we don't really care about the precise probabilities, but just if there is a positive probability that you can go from one state to the next, there is an edge in our model. Okay, and so imagine that this is some kind of river, and there are three cases where the robot is going to be dragged. And the question again is, can he achieve the basic target reachability objective? And in this case, as you can see, it's not possible because due to some unfortunate events, the robot is dragged the middlemost path, and he's stuck in the loop. So, yeah, he's stuck there, so that doesn't work. Okay, so and now the third model I'm going to present to you is the adversarial model. And basically, there is an opponent, and the opponent wants to make us not achieve our objectives. And in this case, again, it's coverage, so he needs to be able to reach all of those. So he needs to reach a vertex in T1 and a vertex in T2. And it's not possible in this case, again, because no matter what we do, player 2 always has some strategy to lead us to this vertex here, where we cannot achieve any objective, and we're done. Okay. And now you might ask, okay, what's the difference between MDPs and game graphs? And the difference of those two models manifests on cycles. So imagine we have the basic target reachability again, and we want to reach from S this vertex in T. if we have the nature model, we will just always go to V2, and at some point nature will send us to our goal, and we're fine. But in the adversarial model, this is not possible, because the opponent will always send us back to our starting destination. Okay, so now to our contribution. We determined the algorithmic complexity of all of those problems in all models, and we, in particular, we present new algorithms for the sequential target problem in MDPs and graphs, so non-trivial algorithms, and we used a recent approach in complexity theory for polynomial time problems, which basically makes sure that you have some bound on the running time. And this is mainly used to make sure that there is no linear time running, so there is no linear time algorithm for this problem. Mm-hmm. And in this talk, I'm going to focus on one result, which is the conditional lower bound for coverage in games. Okay, so this is again our results, and so what we have found out is that the basic target problem in graphs, let's look at graphs, let's focus on graphs first. The basic target problem, easy on graphs. The coverage problem is also easy on graphs. Sequential targets, also easy on graphs. So the basic target is basically breadth first search. So I guess most of you will know this. And so all problems are easy. On MDPs, basic target is not easy, but I'm not going to go into detail here due to time constraints. The coverage problem, we have a lower bound, so this is also not easy. So you need k times m, where k is the number of targets. And you have the sequential target problem, which is again easy. So we don't have a lower bound here. It's not linear, but we don't have a lower bound because it's between linear and quadratic. And on games on graphs, each of the problems is hard except the basic target reachability problem. Okay, so this is a very nice separations of models and objectives here. And I'm going today focus on this orange bound here, so on the lower bounds for games on graphs in coverage. Okay. So what are conditional lower bounds? So because unconditional lower bounds are very rare, some of you might know unconditional lower bounds for sorting, where you need n log n comparisons for sorting some general set of numbers. The complexity theorists came up with a new technique, so it's recent, not very new, but recent, and what they did was they started from a widely accepted conjecture about the running time of a very well-known problem. So for example, all pair shortest paths, where we know it's n to the 3, or satisfiability, free sum. Free sum is n squared, and yeah. So and then you take this problem in the conjecture and reduce it. You take this problem in the conjecture and reduce from this problem to the problem you want to show that the running time is at least as hard as the running time in the problem of the conjecture. Okay, so one example for this conjecture is the strong exponential time hypothesis. So it's called CEF. And it's a running time bound on set. So I'm not going to go into detail with this one, but on the next one, which is implied by Ceph, and which says there is no, so basically when this fails, then also the running time bound on set fails, and we would have very good and new algorithms for the set problem, okay, for satisfiability. And so what does this conjecture or this problem say? It's called orthogonal vectors problem. So bear with me on this one. So you're given two sets, S1 and S2, of d-bit vectors. The size of the sets is n, and each of those vectors has size d, which is little omega of log n. And so the question is, are there two vectors in S1? So is there one vector in S1 and one vector in S2, and which are orthogonal to each other? Which means that on each position of the vector, where there is a 1 in the first vector, you have a 0 in the second vector. So in this example, you can see it's a yes instance because the first set of vector contains 1, 0, 1, And the second set contains the vectors 0, 1, 0, which is orthogonal to the first one, and therefore it's a yes instance. And so the conjecture, which is implied by the running time on set, says there is no better algorithm than a quadratic in the number of vectors. So n to the squared minus epsilon is not possible for any epsilon greater 0. So you need at least quadratic running time to solve this problem. And this is basically compare everything with everything. Okay? Okay, and now we took this problem and we reduced from it to the coverage problem. So from the problem where you are given this k target sets and you need to make sure that from the starting vertex you are able to reach every target set. Okay. So how does the reduction work? You're starting from starting vertex S, so you put this starting vertex S, and then for each vector in the orthogonal vector problem, you put one vertex, so in this case, four vertices, and then for each dimension, you put another set of vertices, so in this case, it's three because the dimension of the vectors are three, and then every time you have a one in the vector, then you put an edge to the corresponding dimension. So in the last vector has only one in the third dimension, and therefore he has an edge to C3. So X4 has an edge to C3, because this last vertex corresponds to this guy. And then you do the same thing again for the second set of vectors. So if you have a 1, you will be connected to the dimension has an edge to your vector. So again, look at the last vector, it has 1, 1, 1, and therefore every dimension needs to have an edge to this guy. Okay. And now, we can say the following. So we make every guy of the second set a target, and then we say, okay, if player 2, which is actually he has only one choice, if player 2 has a strategy to win this coverage game, so he has a way to make us not reach any target, then there are two orthogonal vectors. Okay, and why is this the case? So let's consider the third vector in the first set. It has two ones, and basically this means that he has an edge to the first dimension and to the third. And as we have said, it's only the orthogonal means that for every dimension where you have a one, there is a zero in the other vector. So this means these dimensions cannot connect to this orthogonal guy in the second set. And this means he cannot go to the corresponding orthogonal vector in the second set. And therefore, it's not reachable. And therefore, from S, player 1 is not able to reach one of the targets. And therefore, it's a negative instance, if and only if there is an orthogonal vector. Okay. And so why does this say anything? This says the following. So if we can solve this, if we now have a procedure to solve coverage in these sparse games faster than m squared, and this is due to the fact that there are O of n log n edges, then we would have a faster algorithm for the coverage problem, for the orthogonal vector problem. And you can also state this with the targets, and yeah, you also have a running time bound in the targets because there are theta of n targets. Okay. So to conclude, we clarified in this paper the landscape of these natural planning objectives. And for future work, we think that for this problem, so the MDPs in sequential targets, there is a gap. Okay, we don't know if there is a better running time. We don't know if there's a better running time than the one we have given, and this is due to some older problem, which due to time constraints I cannot go into. And we are working to solve this problem. And so the future work is to close the complexity gap for this sequential target problem or MDPs, or give a lower bound. So maybe there is a lower bound and we were not able to find it. And also a big other open problem would be conditional lower bounds for other polynomial time problems in planning and AI. Thank you.
We have time for some questions. Shlomo?
Wait.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, throw it. Throw it.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Ooh.
Oh,
problems can be solved using heuristic search.
Yeah.
And can you say something about the complexity in the presence of heuristics?
Yeah, so unfortunately, I mean, this, we cannot say anything about heuristics, right? This is always about solving them exactly, but there might be, it might hint, for example, that the coverage problem is harder, especially on MDPs and games on graphs, because we have these lower bounds. So there might be some hints that this problem is, problems are harder. But we, I mean, if you have a very good heuristic, then yeah, it might still be the case that your heuristic performs really well and yeah.
Anybody else?
I get a good photo. I just wanted to confirm the understanding. So the MDPs and the way you framed it and the games on graphs, does this correspond to notions of fairness? And so you have fairness in MDPs and unfairness in games on graphs?
What do you mean with fairness? Can you?
Okay, so the heritage of non-deterministic planning and where it goes in, fairness is if you see a state infinitely often and you execute the same action infinitely often, every one of its outcomes
you mean like
will happen infinitely often.
You mean like Büchi, where you visit the states?
No, it's a comment on whether or not you can expect some non-zero probability on every one of the outcomes. And so typically, if you have unfair non-determinism, which I think is what the games on graphs is coming from, you need strong solutions with no cycles. But if you have an assumption of fairness, you can cycle because eventually you could break out. Is that mapping correct? Because there is a history of fairness and unfairness discussed in non-deterministic planning that I think maps to these two.
Okay. Yeah, maybe we can talk offline.
Sure.
So, yeah. But the difference between MDPs and game graphs is especially if you have this kind of cycles.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
On MDPs, this is what makes the models different, right? So on MDPs, you can reach even if you are in some vicious cycle, the opponent will let you out at some point with some positive probability.
I think this corresponds directly to fairness and it's been discussed for a few decades, so it'd be good to make the connections.
Yeah, good to know that this is called this fairness. Okay,
yep.
Thank you.
I think we need to move on to the next speaker.
Okay.